I've tried the Zettelkasten system, the Para method, CCC, however many C's Cal Newport put into his organization system. And really, the only thing that comes back to me is that organizing data is really exhausting. I start to wonder what I'm even doing with my life as I spend hours dragging files into particular folders on my desktop. Like, where is this getting anyone? It's the perfect thing that AI should be able to automate for us. Now, it hasn't yet, but the tool I'm reviewing today hopes to solve this problem. It's called RecordsKeeper.AI, and it's currently available for a lifetime deal on AppSumo. Here are the pricing options from AppSumo. I did grab a tier 2 to make this video because one of the most important features, in my opinion, is data rooms, and you don't get that on tier 1. So I moved up to tier 2 so I can show you guys what data rooms actually does. Now, if I were to keep this tool, I would probably move up to tier 3 because that adds data export, and that's something that's very important to me. My first thought when reviewing this tool was security. If I'm going to dump my most important information into this tool, I want to be 100% sure it is secure. So I was happy when I scanned their homepage and found they had a section on security. It's way down here at the bottom, enterprise-grade security and compliance you can trust. And it shows all of their certifications. It even claims to be HIPAA certified, which is something I wasn't expecting. Down in the footer of their website, there is even a data security policy, which when you click on it, it talks more about their policies. Now, it turns out that it looks like they're using AWS, and so they're just insinuating they're secure because they're using AWS. When I reached out to support asking for any documentation showing maybe an independent audit of their security practices, they told me they would get back to me, and that was over a week ago, and I haven't heard back yet. They could just be busy with the AppSumo launch, but I wanted to put that out there. They say they're secure, but I have not seen any third-party verifications that they are. All right, let's take a tour of the tool, and I'm going to tell you the pros and cons about actually using this thing. So first of all, you can see the dashboard, where you get some information about the documents that you've uploaded to their platform. You can add more than just text, by the way. It supports images, video, audio, and other, so whatever that might be. There is a search bar right here on the dashboard where you can enter in a natural language question, and then it will search your documents and pull up the relevant document to answer your question. Like, I uploaded a transcript of my recent Ally review, so I could ask a question like, how much does Ally cost? I'll hit return. It opens up the AI chat. It's going to go search all of the documents that I've already uploaded and should give me an answer here in a moment. And there we go, I've got my answer. There is a free plan so you can try it without any initial cost. And it even finds a quote from the video that says, if you're thinking this is going to be super expensive, it's not. So overall, I'm pretty happy with that answer. It even pulled in the documents where it found the answer. Perfect. Now, so far, this isn't doing anything that Notebook LM can't do. And most people have Notebook LM either through their Google account or their Google Workspace subscription. But there are a few tricks inside of RecordsKeeper AI that is exclusive to this application that does set it apart from Notebook. So stay tuned to find out what those are. Now, first things first, you're going to need to get your documents into the platform. You can do this again from the dashboard. There is an Add New Files button where you can just drop them in here, and that works great. They also support cloud storage, so you can connect up to your Google Drive, your Dropbox, whatever works for you, and it will actually just sync a particular folder, bring everything right into the platform. I did have trouble getting this to work inside of the Safari browser. It worked as soon as I moved over to Chrome. So if you're a Safari user, you're struggling with this, it just basically kind of pooped out on step number 3, where I didn't see the directories. As soon as I switched over to Chrome, for whatever reason, that problem was fixed. Of course, we've got all of the same settings I just showed you, not on the dashboard, but right over here under storage and sync. You can go ahead and just upload your files right here in case you're not on the dashboard. You can see that I was able to sync up my Dropbox account and it worked very well. Now, for the sake of testing live on this video, I'm going to add a file right here because as soon as you upload the file, it doesn't become immediately available. In my initial testing, it said it would take 2 to 3 minutes to process a document, but it was actually taking more like 5 to 6 hours, which is not really a deal breaker in my opinion, but the numbers that it tells you should be the result that you get. It could be a deal breaker, I guess. If you need some important information and you need it now, you want to rely on your tools. So let's go ahead and upload a file here and see if they've improved things over the last week. So I've got a transcript here. It's an SRT file. It's from my most recent video on humanized AI. I'm going to go ahead and upload this. We should see it processing right on the dashboard momentarily here. So now it is uploaded. doesn't mean it's available. If we go down here on the dashboard, you can see that automatically refreshed, and you can see the currently processing file, the humanized AI file, is marked processing. Now, 1 to 2 minutes is the quote. We'll check back momentarily and see if it's actually completed. Now, if I go to this second menu item down where it says docs and records, I get a file structure very much like you might see in any organization system that you might use for your company. Here are a ton of different folders: career and education, digital life and subscriptions, family and household. And if I click on one of these, I can see there are actually folders nested underneath. And some of them are blue and some of them are gray. That's because when you upload a file, it automatically puts it inside of a folder. And if you have any data in that folder, it switches from gray to blue. So you can very clearly see which folders you're actually using. Now, you can change this folder system as well. Let's say you're never going to use this for family and household. It's a business tool. You don't want to mix the two. We could go over here to docs and classifications, and you're going to see the entire folder structure. If I didn't want to use family and household, I could triple click right here and hit delete. So the system is actually three-tiered, and then you get to a specific document. So the first tier is the department. The second tier is the document type or category. The third tier is a specific project. And then finally, we get to our targeted document. There is a button down here to add new departments, new categories, and new cases. But if you're used to a particular method, like I mentioned, the para method or the Zettelkasten system at the beginning of the video, well, those are not going to translate directly inside of this tool. On the other hand, I love the fact that I can just dump a bunch of files into the tool and it will organize them for me, and I can use AI to find them. I wish this was honestly built right into my operating system. That would be great. All right, it has been 2 minutes. My file is still currently processing, so we will check back when this is complete. There is an analytics and reports section, so you can see how much people are actually accessing specific documents. So the analytics is going to show you the number of requests over time, the department-wide activity, user-wide activity, all of that data, like basically how much are you using this tool. The reports are going to basically take that information that we just saw on the analytics dashboard and then turn it into a document that you could share with the rest of your company if need be. Personally, I don't see much need for this reporting section, but it is kind of surprisingly full featured. We can generate a report right over here. I'm going to do a new report. I'll choose new report because I don't have any templates. By the way, they don't give you any templates to start with, and that would be nice in my opinion. Give the report a name. I can choose the type of report that I want: an access report, an edit report, a modification report, a deletion report, or an upload report. Choose the departments and categories, set the time period, and then output to an Excel file. These reports can be scheduled. So if you want to do a weekly or monthly report of who has edited a particular file, you could definitely do that. By the way, 6 minutes in, still processing. Now, there are still two big features to look at: data rooms and digital signing. But before we get there, I want to call attention to policies and rules, a really boring feature, but one that's pretty important. So by default, there are some policies in place for the data that you upload to this system. It's going to delete automatically after 10 years. Well, delete is the word that they use, but by default, it's actually set to go into archival. So basically, it will no longer be available to your platform. It'll be archived. I assume there's a way to bring that back, but since 10 years have not passed, I don't really know. Now, you can change this under retention. You can set the span that you want. It could be days or months if you want things to automatically eviscerate themselves. You could do that. But most people, I assume, are going to want to keep things for the long term. So just make sure you go in here and set up the policies so that they work for your company and your platform. Next up is access logs. They call this audits and logs, but it's essentially two different types of logs. We've got access logs, so we can see who has logged in, and we also have activity logs, so we can actually see activities that have taken place. So right now, everything is blank. I don't have other users on the platform, but this definitely will be useful if you have a larger company and you want to see who is coming and going. This kind of ties into our analytics and reports, but in my mind, it's a little bit more like having a security system where you can just go back and see what actually happened using the cameras. I mean, it's not recording the screen, but it'll give you a log. Next up is data rooms, which could be the coolest feature of the entire application if they were working, which in my account, at least, they are not. The premise is really cool. So the idea is to use a very secure connection, basically using the blockchain to make sure that everything is super secure so that you can share confidential information with people who need to see it. So what we would do hypothetically is go over to data rooms right here, create a data room, give it a name and description. You can even add an image for your data room. This one will do. It uploads, encodes, and then your data room will be ready to roll, where you should be able to add folders and files to the data room. So here is the one I just created 0 minutes ago. I've done this multiple times. It never actually works. Then I go under view details and try to add a folder, and I'll just call this my folder. Hit create folder, and it says that I don't have permission to do that. Okay, well, maybe I don't have folders allowed. I mean, I can check my settings, and I definitely have AppSumo tier 2. Yeah, here's my billing and quota just for confirmation, and I'm on AppSumo tier 2, which gives me 3 data rooms as we saw earlier. Tier 2, 3 data rooms. I notice there is a file section over here, and there's actually some folders already pre-existing. So if I just wanted to add a file to one of these folders, maybe it would appear in the data room. So I click on the big upload files button. I get the option to upload a file or link to a URL. I've tried both, but let's go ahead and upload a file together. Here's an image. I'm going to upload this. It uploads fine seemingly, but then when I go and hit save changes, the button doesn't work. The only thing I can do is hit cancel. Okay, so let's go ahead and pull in a file from a URL. I'm gonna pull open my website here, daveswift.com, and here's an image. I'm gonna right click to get that image address. I'll add the URL. I'll call it my image, hit save changes, and then it says the URL does not appear to be a file link. So I don't know what they're looking for here, but I can't seem to add any data to my data room. Hypothetically, this would be really cool because when I turn on a data room, it now becomes published. And if I view the data room, I can actually share this securely with other people. I create a link up here. I can set a passcode. This is definitely a step above just sharing a random file to a Dropbox or a Google Drive link. So I don't know, maybe it's user error here, but for some reason, this just is not working for me. There is one more feature to show you, digital signing, and it does work. I'll show it to you in a moment. But first, I'm just going to show you under settings. A couple of cool things is under user settings, you can set up AI memory so that it answers your chats in a way that you prefer. I think that's really cool. The other thing I was going to mention is that under company settings, you can actually brand this exactly to your brand. You can set the colors and upload your own logo, something that's very important to a lot of businesses out there. So thought I would mention that is baked in. All right, digital signing, something that is included with a lot of things these days. I think Dropbox does it, Google Drive does it. Of course, AppSumo has got their great Breeze Doc tool. I use that all of the time, but we can do it here inside of RecordsKeeper AI, which might be kind of handy, except that it doesn't actually see your existing documents. So this is almost like an entirely separate tool. That's fine. You just might find out that you're uploading the same document inside of, let's say, like, you know, if something gets signed, it doesn't automatically go into your overall storage. You have to move it back and forth by downloading it and re-uploading it. By the way, let's check. 27 minutes ago, we uploaded this and it is still processing. But okay, all of that aside, let's go ahead and show you how the document setup actually works. This is pretty good, to be truthful. So I'm gonna go ahead and create a new doc here, and I'll just call it my contract. And I can choose a template here if I had any. I don't have a template, so I'm just gonna leave that blank. And then I can set an expiration date. I'll just do a week in advance as of the recording of this video. And then we'll move to the next section. Now here I need to upload my document. So I'm gonna do that. And I've got a letter here I'm gonna upload. And now I just wanna add in like a signature. Well, I could just click right here, then draw a field on the letter. And now I can sign right there. Now, obviously you're gonna use this mostly for contracts. I just grab this as an example document. We can do other things like initials. So I can draw a field where I want the initials to go. And there's radio buttons and checkboxes and all sorts of different features here. I can have multiple people sign this document. So right now it's the first party and I could just call that, you know, Dave, that's gonna be me. And then I can add in a secondary party by clicking the plus button and giving that a name. We'll say that's Dan. And now I can add in some fields for Dan. So basically Dan is selected up here and I want Dan to sign right underneath my name. So I'll grab the signature box and just drag it in. And then on the next screen, we've got a field for the signatory name and email address, as well as setting a specific due date for each person. I find that part to be a little bit confusing because I set a due date when I first created the contract, but you get the idea here. We can maybe give someone a deadline, give someone else a little bit more time. Now, the one thing is that there's a lot of scams right now with fake DocuSign type services, sending people messages and then doing nefarious things. So I did find that their email deliverability for particularly the document signing was not great. It went to spam in my iCloud and it was delivered through my Gmail account, but it took a very long time, like 10 or 15 minutes after it was sent, did it actually make it through Google, and they determined that, yeah, it was valid. This is no fault of RecordsKeeper. This is mostly the fault of the scammers of the world that have made sending out a request for a document a little bit more difficult than it should be. I know I have received those types of scammy emails, and sometimes they're done quite well. They look like they're from lawyers or important people, and your heart races for a moment before you realize that it was sent from like a junk Gmail address, not actually DocuSign. So beware out there, kids. The internet's dangerous these days. All right, so I filled in some placeholder information here. We can go to the next screen. We get a preview. This is basically just saying like, here's what you're gonna do. You're gonna ask these people to use these names and sign by this date. Okay, great, let's hit send. And then it is sent out. And now we can see what it actually looks like to receive a document using this service, what the signature process is like. So here is the view, very, very simple. So I can go ahead and initial right here. I can either draw if I prefer, or I can simply type. I'll type in right here, hit complete, and then I've got the signature field down below. Again, I can draw if I prefer, or I can go over to typing. When I'm all done, I'll hit the big complete button, and we are good to go. Well, we're about done with this video, and it's been 34 minutes. It is still processing. So just know that if you upload a lot of documents here, it's gonna take a while before you can actually analyze them, but it does get done eventually. All right, so final thoughts here. I think the concept behind RecordsKeeper AI is a strong one. This is something that people need solved in their lives and in their businesses. The execution, well, not so great. Hit and miss in different areas. The categorization of documents is actually pretty good. When it actually gets through the upload process, goes ahead and processes, it does put it in a folder that makes sense, and the AI search works really well. But the other end of it, like the features that I was most excited about, like data rooms, just didn't really work at all. So if you're upgrading specifically for that feature like I was, at least as of the time of this recording, it was really disappointing. It also doesn't look like data rooms play well with your other files, just like digital signing didn't seem to know about the other files you had uploaded at all. I think some cross-pollination there just makes a lot of sense, because you're gonna wanna organize the signatures that you receive, and you're gonna wanna, you know, share actual files in your repository with other people, which is where the data rooms come into play. So there's a lot of room for improvement here, some good things to get started, but I just don't think it's quite ready for prime time. And there's that whole deal with never getting back to me with their third-party audits or any sort of certifications for security. Just puts up too many red flags in my book personally. So I'm gonna go ahead and give RecordsKeeper AI a 4.8 out of 10. So this is a great concept. If they get all of their ducks in a row, fix all of their features, they could really have a strong product on their hands. But I think it's kind of funny that I would rather upload my data to Google, who we basically know is going to use for not really positive things. They're going to scan them and train their LLMs on them and possibly use them to market back against me. And yet we still feed them lots of data without any second thought, at least for most of us. So that's going to do it for this video. If you want to grab a copy of RecordsKeeper AI, try it out for yourself, or maybe you want something else at AppSumo, you can support this content by clicking on my links in the description. Thanks to everybody who does that. If you're new around here, make sure you get subscribed, hit the like button if you like the content, and I'll see you in the next review.